So first of all, thank you all for being here this evening for America's Futures Foundation San Francisco chapter discussion on America's rich and poor divide. My name is Paul Doherty, and I'm the chapter chair for San Francisco chapter, which recently launched with an event in April. Real quick about America's Futures Foundation, it's a premier nationwide network of liberty-minded young professionals. We started the chapter here a couple months ago, as I mentioned. However, AFF as a national organization has been around since 1995, so we just celebrated our 20th anniversary, which is a big event for us. For those who are unfamiliar with AFF, we are a nonprofit, nonpartisan educational organization that's dedicated to promoting the ideals of free enterprise, individual liberty, and personal responsibility, and entrepreneurship. We don't advocate for or against any party or any specific policy or candidate, but what we do is we talk about the most important cultural and political issues of the day, such as America's rich and poor divide and income inequality. You can find more information about AFF at americasfuture.org, and you can follow along at Twitter at AFF_SF, and we'll be using the hashtag tonight if you want to tweet along, America's Future. So hashtag America's Future. Before we begin, I'd like to thank the Arthur N. Roop Foundation for giving us a donation so we could put on tonight's event. I'd also like to thank the Hoover Institution, the Pacific Research Institute, the Atlas Network, and the Libertarian Party of San Francisco for their support in publicizing the event. And I can't leave out the good folks here at Runway Incubator for giving us this space tonight. And so now with that, I'd like to introduce you to one of our speakers, DeRoy Murdock. Mr. Murdock is a New York commentator and a nationally syndicated columnist with the Scripps Howard News Service. He's also a senior fellow with the Atlas Network, and he is a supporter of about 470 free market think tanks around the world in 90 different countries, and his column reaches approximately 400 newspapers across the U.S. each week. I would definitely recommend checking out some of his columns if you haven't before. So thank you for being here this evening, and we really appreciate your coming out and showing support. And DeRoy, thank you as well for being here. What we'll do is DeRoy is going to have a short presentation for us and on this evening's topic, and then we'll have Dr. Tim Kane come in here, and we'll do a short debate discussion, and we'll follow that up with some questions from the audience. So with that, I'll turn it over to DeRoy.
Thank you very much, Paul. It's great to be here with you, and I want to say thank you as well to Tanya Treble and the other people involved in America's Future Futures Foundation for inviting me here to be with you, and thank you to all the other folks you mentioned who are involved in supporting this organization. I thought I'd give you guys a little small communications tip in case you're ever in this situation and need to give a speech, and that is don't catch a cold the night before. So I've been sipping tea and chewing up Ricolas, so if my voice is faltering, that's why, and I'll try to do my best, and the microphone certainly helps. So thanks again for taking time out of your busy days to be here to talk about this topic. I thought I would mention briefly the Atlas Network, with which I'm a senior fellow. We're based in Washington, D.C. I live in New York City, but Atlas is based in Washington, D.C., and as Paul said, we support free market think tanks around the world. I think one way to understand what we do, we're sort of like Johnny Cato Seed or Johnny PRI Seed. We help launch and nurture free market think tanks in the U.S. and abroad, and we've been doing so since about 1981, and I think we're now up to about 470 free market think tanks in about 94 countries, I think it is. We were founded by a man named Sir Anthony Fisher, who also was he also founded the Pacific Research Institute here in San Francisco, and we always have very good relations with our friends at PRI, so if you're interested, learn more about Atlas Network at atlasnetwork.org. So before we do anything else, let's do a thought experiment. Let's imagine that you are considering a couple of job offers, and this is job offer A. You're offered $50,000, and your boss will make $55,000, and that represents income inequality of 10%. And I think even Occupy Wall Street would be comfortable with that level of income inequality. So that's job offer A. Here's job offer B. You get offered $500,000, and your boss is offered $1 million, making double what you do. Income inequality of 100%. So, again, your two options are job offer A and job offer B. How many for job offer A? How many for job offer B? Many more people for job offer B. I think that this little thought experiment completely demolishes the rhetoric we've been hearing for the last couple of years about the income gap and income inequality and all that. It's all about, well, you know, we got to equalize this whole thing. I think the focus shouldn't be on can we get everyone equal and particularly bring people from the top down. The discussion needs to be how do we get people from the bottom up. And if people are going to get wealthier at the top in that process, if it means that people at the bottom are getting higher and moving upward, that's what we need to focus on. I think the national discussion should be about how we make this happen rather than how we make this happen. One is a productive discussion. One is a very destructive and dangerous discussion, as I think you'll see. And again, the rhetoric is all about inequality and how inequality is awful. And I think when we talk about this, we want to make clear that when we talk about equality, I think we all agree as Americans in the idea of equal justice under law. We're all equal before the government, whether you're old, young, rich, poor, black, white, whatever your background is, we all should be treated the same by the government. When you're talking about equality of results, so everybody ends up with the same exact paycheck, that's altogether a different concept. I'd like to show this illustration. This is on the left, John Cleese, who went on to great fame and fortune in Monty Python's Flying Circus. And these two guys in the middle on the right are a British a comedy troupe called the Two Ronnies. And when we talk about we want to make everyone equal, I think it's as absurd as saying, well, why don't we take John Cleese's shoes off, or feet off, or maybe cut them off at the knees and put his knees under this guy so they'll all be the same. People start off unequal, people end up unequal. And what you want to do is make it possible without using the blunt force instrument of government to equalize people, to make it possible for people to rise to whatever their highest possible, highest potential they could have based on creating incentives and creating the kind of conditions where people can flourish and prosper and through their own efforts get to be somebody tall like John Cleese rather than propping somebody up like trying to push this guy up with John Cleese's lower legs. Now you hear this sort of rhetoric such as this from James Clyburn, who's a member of the U.S. House from South Carolina, and he said, the gap continues to grow wider between those who enjoy great wealth and those who struggle to get by with little thought of ever getting ahead. This is kind of the ongoing theme here in the income inequality movement. Instead of believing that a rising tide lifts all boats, class warriors act as if they want to drain the lake so all the boats are equally grounded. That seems to be the manner of thinking behind this particular movement. And you see this in popular culture, such as here. Here we have Mr. Burns from The Simpsons, and the news says 1% recovering nicely from recession, 99% not so much. And of course, Mr. Burns is excellent. You saw it certainly in the 2012 political campaign where Mitt Romney, evil man who had a hedge fund and made all this money on Wall Street and all that, and he was vilified by the media, many political activists. There he is holding holding cash in his hand, wearing a top hat. These guys always have top hats on. And there he is kicking the poor blue-collar worker in the butt. What people don't talk about is the fact that his hedge fund made a lot of money by investing money from CalPERS, California Public Employees Research Retirement System, the Teachers Union Pension System, the Illinois Public Workers System. A lot of the money that his company made was by investing the work of unionized, or investing the retirement funds of unionized employees so they would have prosperous retirement accounts. But he was too modest to talk about that, and despite that, he was attacked by the very people whose retirement money his company was investing very well, by the way. A lot of this stuff looks like what you'd see. This is a proletariat at the top. This is from an Australian labor-oriented magazine. And there's this worker with his sleeves rolled up, just using a big pickaxe to knock this capitalist where the sun don't shine, and off pops his top hat. So this is rhetoric you'd see back in the 1930s, except you're hearing it and seeing it in 2015. And you hear it and see it from the very, very top of America's political structure. Such as here. The deck is stacked for those at the top. There's something wrong when CEOs make 300 times more than the typical worker, said Hillary Clinton not very long ago. Here we have Obama saying, I do think at a certain point you've made enough money. So those of you who are in the tech sector here making a lot of cash, at some point you've made enough and you can stop and just send it to Washington where people like Obama will do wonderful things with it. Or so he says. If asking a millionaire to pay the same tax rate as a plumber makes me a class warrior, a warrior for the working class, I will accept that. I will wear that charge as a badge of honor, Obama said. If you've got a business, you didn't build that. Somebody else made that happen. He said that during the 2012 campaign, and a lot of people who run their own companies, started their own startups, et cetera, did not appreciate that comment. You hear this as well from Bernie Sanders, U.S. Senator from Vermont, who is a socialist. That's not my term. That's his term. When the rich get richer, they say, I'm not rich enough. I need to be richer. What motivates some of these people is greed and greed and more greed. Here's Michael Moore, a man who's been sliding by in his good looks for the last 30 years or so. They're sitting on the money. That's not theirs. That's a national resource. That's ours. So it doesn't even belong to them. It's not their money. It's our money, he says, the man who lives in a penthouse in Manhattan. This is a rapper who lives in Oakland, San Francisco Bay Area rapper, Boots Riley. He wrote a rap song which goes, toss a dollar in the river, and when he jump in, if you can find he can swim, put lead boots on him and do it again. So let's drown the CEOs. Here's Roseanne Barr. And I can't quite see the top there, but it says, I first would allow the guilty bankers the ability to pay back anything over $100 million personal wealth because I believe in a maximum wage of $100 million. And if they're unable to live on that amount, then we should go. They should go to the re-education camps. And if that doesn't help, then be beheaded. So let's take the rich people and chop their heads off, advises Roseanne Barr, who's probably got $100 million in the bank, I would think. And I wonder if she'd make that same comment about someone like Steven Spielberg in her industry. He's probably got $1 billion or close to it in the bank. Eat the rich, the other white meat. Even more aggressive, kill and eat the rich. So not just eat them, make sure and kill them first with the knife and fork there. And then this one's really nice. It says, class war, we have found new homes for the rich. Now this is really nasty stuff. Imagine if it said, we have found new homes for the Jews, or we have found new homes for the blacks, or we have found new homes for the gays, and you see all these tombstones. People wouldn't find that very funny. And yet you make this kind of a comment about the rich, people say, oh, that's kind of cute. Isn't that entertaining? And I think it's really sick and horrible and totally inappropriate in our society. This says, burn the rich, the condos, and has the A for anarchy sign. And some people take this sort of stuff seriously, such as this was November 2010. An arsonist burned down a $500,000 home in the Cape Cod area. And then a few days later, another home went up in smoke in a place called Trotter's Lane in near Sandwich as well. And in both cases, what the person did who burned down one house and tried to burn another wrote F the rich graffitied on the side of the house. So this is evidently the same person or people not liking rich people and attempting to destroy two houses and actually succeeding in destroying one of them. Then there's a gunman who went into a Florida school board meeting and decided that he wasn't very happy. And so he pulled a gun out on the school board and started shooting at them. And you can see him firing there, the school board members ducking down beneath the table. They all survived. He then turned the gun on himself and killed himself. And the police then took a look at his on-site manifesto. And he said the following, I was just born poor in a country where the wealthy manipulate, use, abuse, and economically enslave 95% of the population. Our masters, the wealthy, do as they like to us. So again, it's this hate the wealthy attitude. And this guy actually went in and started opening fire on people as a consequence. There's a bridge in Oklahoma, not far from Cleveland. Near Cleveland. And these are really nice guys here. It says, five arrested in alleged plot to blow up Cleveland area bridge. And these folks, as it turns out, had a very interesting motivation. These anarchists, three of them employees of Occupy Cleveland, wanted to make sure everyone knows that the action was against corporate America and the financial system and not just some random act. So their plan is to blow up that bridge as a way of getting back at the rich people and showing their solidarity with the working class. So this is very, very, very violent stuff. In New York State, lawmakers received a threatening letter in the mail about a year ago, January of 2014, a year and a half ago, and said it was time to kill the wealthy. The death threat continued. If you don't, I'm going to pay a visit with my carbine to one of those tech companies you're so proud of and shoot every spoiled Ivy League blank I can find. So again, a tremendous amount of hostility and violence and so on being geared towards people who make means because of this whole concept. Here again, fueling this is James Clyburn, congressman from South Carolina. He said, 98% of the American people are carrying this tax load, while the other 2% seem to be getting away scot-free, and that's not fair.
How much of this money is he giving back?
I'm sorry?
Probably
not as much as he wants the other folks to give back, I'm guessing. So this is actually almost pristinely 180 degrees upside down. In fact, what you see is the wealthy paying a lot of taxes, and those less wealthy paying a whole lot less, and very often none at all. So when we talk about the 1%, this is what we're talking about, people making about $380,000, $400,000. That represents the cutoff, the floor of the 1%. And on average, these people are paying an AGI, adjusted gross income, about $1.14 million. So of this 1%, there they are in red, the bottom 99% in blue. The top 1% make 19% share of national income, share of national AGI, and the 99% make 81%, all right? So they make 19% of adjusted gross income, grand total nationwide, and they pay about 35% of taxes, all right? So what we've got here, again, this is unfair. It's a portrait of unfairness. Top 1% of the filers make 19% of national income and pay 35% of income taxes. So when you hear people say, oh, the top 1%, they're not paying their taxes, they're just sliding by, they're sloughing off. They're paying, these 1% are paying 35% of national income taxes. I think that is more than their fair share. And then you look down here on the other side, the bottom 50%, the lower half of the income distribution, they're paying 2.8% of income taxes paid on income about 11%. So the bottom half is only paying about 3% of income taxes, the top 1% is paying 35%. These are figures you're not going to hear from people like Nancy Pelosi, who probably represents this building, I'm assuming. People say, well, what about, you know, that? Okay, that's just income tax, but what if you throw in payroll taxes, death taxes, everything else? You put all the taxes together, and here again, you find that all taxpayers on average are paying about 20%, and people making million plus are paying 31%. People 50 to 75,000 or under that, they're making about 15.7. So the more you make, the more you pay. That's the way it works in the society, despite the rhetoric to the contrary. Also interesting is how many people pay no tax. This is as of 2011. 45% of people who send in their taxes don't pay anything. 45, we'll take questions afterwards. 45% are paying nothing. So again, you don't hear much of that when we hear about the unfairness of all of this. And here's Obama saying, I won't allow the half of Americans who pay no taxes to bear the burden of the other half who aren't paying their fair share. Just to be clear about what he's thinking. We have here again Bernie Sanders saying, these people who are worth hundreds of millions of dollars, maybe they've got to go back to the Bible or whatever they believe in, understanding that there is virtue in sharing and reaching out that you can't get at all. The theme here is these people get their money, hide it under their beds, and don't share it with anybody. Well, interestingly enough, there's an annual or biennial survey, the 2014 U.S. Trust Study of High Net Worth Philanthropy, and they took a look at the giving patterns of very wealthy people, specifically people with household income of $200,000 or more, independent of their homes, average net worth of $14.9 million. So these are people about $15 million in the bank, right? And what do they do with their money? It turns out, in 2013, did you or anyone in your household give to charity? Average American, about 65%. These very rich people, 98.4%. Almost all of these people donate money. They give to secular causes and to religious causes as well, in both cases more than the general population. Number one, they give to education. Number two, they give to basic needs. So they're giving to the Salvation Army, they're giving to the Goodwill. Folks are helping people in real need, and only after they're taking care of students and people in real dire straits do they finally get around to taking care of the ballet, the symphony, this sort of thing. They also fund hospitals, religious institutions, and so on. And in addition to giving money, they volunteer. What percentage of these people volunteered? 75% of these folks not just write checks, they also volunteer and donate their money, they donate their time, and 34% of them are donating more than 200 hours a year. And if you're somebody who's got a giant hedge fund, your time is worth a lot of money, and we're donating 200 hours of your time, that's worth a lot of cash. And again, they get no credit for that. And you get people like Ken Langone, who's one of the co-founders of Home Depot. He was on the board of directors of the New York Stock Exchange. He donated $200 million to New York University. I said, NYU Medical Center, and said, do what you want with it. I just want my name on the front door. So it's now the Ken Langone NYU Medical Center. And with the $200 million, they put in new facilities. They're curing diseases, taking care of people. And that was a very generous gift. Here is a man, you've probably heard his name, David Koch, one of the Koch brothers, about whom we hear things all the time. And among many things he's done, he donated $100 million to what was called the New York State Theater in New York City. It's now called the David Koch Theater. The ballet has held there, and they did $100 million worth of renovations to put together this beautiful facility you see here. Anybody know what that is? This is the Korean Peninsula by day, by satellite. So that's what it looks like if you're in the space shuttle looking down. I guess it would be the space station now looking down at Earth. And this is what it looks like at night. And there you see in the South Korea, you see all the lights of Seoul, the lights of Busan, and these other cities, where you have income inequality. You've got people in townhouses, penthouses. You have people in studio apartments. You have people living in group homes, what have you. So you have a lot of inequality, but you also got the lights on. Then you have North Korea, where people are pretty equal. They've got income equality there, with the exception of Kim Jong-un, who's doing much better. But apart from him, everyone's pretty equal. And guess what? The sun goes down, and they go back to the 18th century, okay? So there's some income inequality for you. Great words from Abraham Lincoln on this, or at least attributed to him. You cannot strengthen the weak by weakening the strong. You cannot help the poor man by destroying the rich. And you cannot further the brotherhood of man by inciting class hatred. So instead of class hatred and this whole idea of let's beat up on the rich and that's how we're going to save the country, I think a much better method to do this, much better approach, is to focus on upward mobility, social mobility, economic growth, and moving people up the ladder. This has to be the model. Don't tear the people out of the penthouses. Get the people on the sidewalks, indoors, and up the stairs, and that will be a much better society than when we're attacking the rich and in some cases physically attacking them and even engaging in arson and shootings. There's a very good article in today's Investor's Business Daily. This came out just this morning. And this chart shows economic freedom around the world from 1970 onward. And you can see the rest of the world has been improving and getting freer. Whereas the United States, since about the year 2000, which is when George W. Bush got elected, and of course followed by Obama, we've seen economic freedom going down. And this is a bipartisan problem. This is a problem which really accelerated under G.W. Bush, and this is part of the Bush family's way of doing things, in my opinion. And then Obama has continued. You see economic freedom going down. And as that's happened, you've seen all sorts of very negative repercussions. And I'll quote these folks. I had some pretty good comments on this. Again, this is from today's Investor's Business Daily. High and rising economic freedom spurs the creation of capital in all its forms, planting the seeds for rising living standards. Where economic freedom falters, capital will be scarce, misused, and poorly maintained. Over time, people will become poorer. And that's what's happening in this country right now as economic growth has slowed down, or in the case of last quarter, actually reversed. Okay, here we've got Obama next to a snail. It says, ta-da, it moved. Look, it moved again and again, back a tiny bit, but it moved. And there's the economy crawling forward. We initially grew, the initial estimate was we grew 0.2% last quarter. That was revised by the Department of Commerce. We actually shrank 0.7. If we have another negative quarter this quarter, we'll be officially in recession. And under this president, we've seen economic growth just barely moving forward, very often stopping or going backwards, not the kind of robust recovery you expect to see after an economic slowdown. And people are hurting, and this is a large part of the reason for the anger you see around the country. This puts it in pretty stark relief. These are the economic recovery has generated a large and persistent private sector gap. So this is what the Obama job creation performance looks like down here. This is the recovery in blue of an average recovery after a recession from 1960 onward. And then here's what things would look like under Reagan's set of conditions. So you've got Obama performing not just worse than Reagan, but indeed worse below average. This is a very poor performance we've seen. And people are suffering as a consequence in general. Black people in particular are suffering. Here's how things look under Obama for black folks who gave 95% of their votes to Obama. And here's how things look like under Reagan-type conditions. Huge increase in the employment rate if comparing Obama to Reagan, with Reagan ahead and Obama behind. And here again, you see the Reagan recovery versus Obama recovery. You're talking about a difference of about exactly 2 million jobs that are missing in among black Americans because of the Obama-type conditions we have rather than the Reagan-type conditions we have after this previous recession. What do we do about this? One of the things we need to do desperately is tax relief in this country. We have very high taxes. We have the kind of taxes that scare people away from investing and often either cause jobs to be moved offshore or the jobs to get started offshore and aren't even here. So you see the corporate tax rates for the U.S., 39.21 combined, federal and state on average. France, 34.43, Germany, 30.18, Ireland down at 12.5. We have the highest corporate tax rates in the developed world. That is not the kind of accolade we ought to embrace.
We, you mean Americans?
We Americans, correct. This is the U.S. tax code, pages in the tax code. You can see that's gone up, 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 up to 2014. The tax rules amounting to almost 75,000 pages. Nobody has any idea what's in this. You can call the IRS and say, look, I make this kind of income. I've got these many deductions, this kind of a house, these many cars, blah, blah, blah. What should I pay in taxes? You talk to five people, the IRS, you get seven or eight different answers. This is just a complete mystery document. It needs to be thrown out, tossed out, and replaced, I think, with a flat tax, which you can put on one or two pages and keep it very simple and not create this elaborate work of literature that's unfathomable than James Joyce or other difficult authors. This says at the top, we will not be adding more to the national debt, Obama said at a press conference in 2011. And here you can see the national debt increasing on and on and on as Uncle Sam continues to borrow all this money. A lot of people like to say, well, look, you know, we don't want to pass these bills along to our children, and that's not fair to the grandchildren, and on and on and on. There's a real danger in that rhetoric, because when you talk about the national debt being something that causes the children and grandchildren to suffer, some people figure, well, let them figure it out. When they grow out, they're smart, they'll figure it out. In the meantime, we're going to keep spending and enjoy the party. People are suffering today in June of 2015, because of all this massive federal borrowing. A very smart economist named David Malpass, who used to be in the Reagan Treasury Department, has followed this. And if you can see the amount of money that's been loaned to the government, number one in the red line, up, up, and away. Number two is households, so regular household borrowing, that's been pretty flat. Non-financial corporate businesses, they've gone up a bit, but not that much. And then down here, you can see the non-corporate businesses, small startups, non-incorporated companies, completely flat from 2008 onward. Look at that. And yet the government basically goes in. What essentially happens is the government goes in and says, all right, we want to borrow money. They clear the vault out. And then if you're a small startup or you're trying to do something with get a bank loan without the kind of credit rating that a Fortune 500 company has, they say, all right, good luck. Good luck to you. You know, good luck with your new invention. Good luck with your new company. Hope it all works out. But we don't have any money to lend because Uncle Sam just came in and cleared the vault out. And there's Uncle Sam saying, see ya. Grabs the money and goes. And the result of that is people waiting in unemployment lines. What do we do about this? There are many different ways of handling it. I like something called the penny plan, which is very simple. In the year 2015, the federal government will spend $1. 2016, they'll spend 99 cents of that dollar. 2017, 98 cents of that dollar, and so on. So every year, the federal government cuts spending by 1%. And if you're running HHS or the FDA or the VA or whatever facility it may be, somebody says to you, the president says, all right, Paul, Secretary of Agriculture, Paul Daugherty, your job is to cut spending by 1%. And you work on it. You figure it out. And we're going to cut that by 1%. And next year, cut another percent. And the good news is, over 10 years, we'd save $7.6 trillion. And we'd be well on the way to knocking down, making a huge reduction in the national debt. We have a big problem with regulations in this country, among them Obamacare. This is what it looks like when you print out Obamacare and put it next to Senator Mitch McConnell. It's about 11,000 pages put through a printer. And again, elaborate detail, nobody understands, totally confusing. The Joint Economic Committee tried to put together a schematic to show how Obamacare works, how the different cogs and wheels are connected. And here's what they put together. There it is. Okay. All right. That's if you put together a schematic of Obamacare, that's what it looks like. If you open up your cell phones, your computers, look inside at the silicon chips, they look kind of like that, don't they? All right. So we could have taken many different ways to address the problem of people not having health insurance or being unable to pay their bills. I don't think we needed to do this. So it's incredibly elaborate and complicated and baffling. It's also very expensive. This is the cost of Obamacare up, up, and away. Originally, when it passed, it was supposed to cost just under $1 trillion, $900 billion. That was the original price tag. We're now up to $2.6 trillion. It's now tripled in price over between 2010 and 2015. And my guess is the price is going to keep going up, up, and away. So we're already at a 3X increase in the price of Obamacare, and it's just getting started. Other regulations. The federal government right now is working on regulations on ceiling fans. So if you want to buy a ceiling fan, the people who make them are dealing with Washington, D.C. Department of Energy wants to make sure ceiling fans are energy efficient, all that. So you can't even make a ceiling fan in this country without Washington breathing down your neck. Gibson Guitar Company had a huge problem. They imported rosewood and ebony, and that violates the laws of India. We have something called the Lacey Act, which says the U.S. government has to enforce Indian law from East India. Rather than come in and just say, hey, look, can we work this out? There's a problem here. They sent in a SWAT team. The SWAT team, dressed up as if these were bank robbers, burst into Gibson Guitar in Memphis. I think they also went to their facility in Nashville, grabbed guitars, grabbed rosewood, grabbed ebony wood, put the staff all in the cafeteria, held them at gunpoint. This is how Uncle Sam behaves today. So you see that and you think, gee, I want to start a guitar factory. You think, nah, I'm not going to start a guitar factory. People see this sort of thing, and we see companies that close. What we never see are the companies that don't open in the first place, because people see stories like this and think, you know what, I'm not going to bother opening a company if that's the way the U.S. government behaves. Education, another hugely important aspect of all this. What do we do about helping people become upwardly mobile? We need to address the dreadful situation of education in the United States right now. People say we need to spend more money. Okay, here's what we've done in terms of spending. Going back to 1970, you can see here's the blue line is spending. The yellow line is employees, how many people work for government school districts and so on. And the flat lines you see there, reading scores, math scores, science scores. So over a 40-year period, tremendous increase in expenditure, totally flat in terms of performance. So when people say spend more money, we've tried this. It's like defibrillating somebody who's not coming back to life. Obama did not help by killing the DC voucher program when he came in. He decided to send his daughters, said, well, friends, good for them. I hope they're getting a terrific education at the most expensive, most prestigious private school in Washington, D.C. And then he kills the DC voucher program, which helps 98% black kids in Washington, D.C. have some chance of actually succeeding in that terrible school district. Fortunately, John Boehner and former Senator Lieberman of Connecticut got money and brought it back to life. But every year Obama tries to kill the D.C. voucher program, the Republicans put money back in. This is an example of what happens in charter schools. This is the Harlem Success Academy. These are Hispanic kids in this charter school in Harlem. These are poor kids in Harlem. At this charter school, they're getting on math 97%, the Hispanics. The black kids are getting 94% scores. The white kids around the state, 73%. And then here in English, the Hispanic kids are getting scores of 89%, black 79, white kids elsewhere 66. So rather than just let's spend more money, let's put people where they have educational freedom, where the schools actually have accountability, where if they screw up, they get fired, rather than the government school system where you can't get fired, even engaging a child molestation will keep you on the payroll, and I'm not kidding when I say that. So this is more the model we need rather than that giant spending curve. I want to see signs like this, now hiring now, right now, we're hiring now. I want to see signs like that all around the country. I want people to drive down every corner to see this sort of thing. So Americans go back to work, Americans can make money, Americans can invest, take care of themselves, take care of their loved ones, and this whole income inequality issue will go away as people start going up, up, and away, rather than being stagnant and very sad, which is what we have now. And here we have the late, great Milton Friedman, one of the greatest thinkers our country's produced, who said, the record of history is absolutely crystal clear. There is no alternative way, so far discovered, of improving the lot of the ordinary people that can hold a candle to the productive activities that are unleashed by the free enterprise system. Very wise words then, and very wise words today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, DeRoy. And now I'd like to also welcome up here Tim Kane, our other debate participant. Have a seat here, Tim. Thanks for joining us. Tim is a research fellow at Stanford University, the Hoover Institution, and has twice served as a senior economist on the Joint Economic Committee of the U.S. Congress. So thank you for being here. Yeah, glad you're able to make it in time and get not get stuck in too much traffic. So I wanted to have a few questions prepared, and I just wanted to start with a quick reaction to DeRoy's presentation here and talk a little bit about whether you or not you agree that public policy should aim to lift low incomes via policies such as the minimum wage. So, raising the minimum wage seems to be a real common solution that's trotted out there in addressing the wealth gap. LA just passed it last week. Their city council raising it to $15. California is already saying that we're going to have a $10 minimum wage by 2016. San Francisco has it. But we've seen some business, small business owners obviously be affected by that and come out against that. So I would love to just get your perspective on whether or not this is a state or a federal issue, you know, such as a national living wage, or are there other approaches or policies that would be more effective in raising people's incomes?
Is that for me or is that
for you? For both.
Sure. Well, I guess I can say, do a quick intro, right? Great, thanks. So, I've thought a lot about the inequality issue, and I think it's two things. One, I think it's made up in a lot of ways, and I agree a lot with what DeRoy said, but I think there's another part of it that's very real. And when I talk to people about inequality, I talk as a former entrepreneur who started a company who helped create jobs, saw the joy and the power that had. So I'm kind of addicted to that. Spent 4 years at the Kauffman Foundation studying entrepreneurship, but I really love being a wonk more than entrepreneur. And one of the things that shocked me about inequality is it doesn't resonate as a word. Right? People don't really mind inequality. They mind unfairness. And if that inequality implies unfairness, then they see something wrong, right? So if the color of your skin means you can't play a sport, that strikes a chord with us, right? We really don't like that. And I think where we see inequality manifesting itself and the government has a role is, if the government says everybody deserves a shot, they deserve an education, we're gonna provide that education. But it turns out to be so heavily monopolized that when you have a bad teacher, and it's so bad that other teachers get frustrated and quit, right, so you're bleeding talent out of our education system. And the one statistic I would impress on people when they think about inequality is this. 1 in 7 Americans can't read, functionally illiterate. When I think about inequality, that's the statistic that makes my blood boil, right? I see red. It's not that those 1 in 7 people are poor. Of course they are. And I'm not going to go after the other 6 in 7 or the people in here that are part of companies that are creating wealth, that are creating jobs. It's those least advantaged. That's, I think, the killer issue. And it's a bipartisan issue, or it should be. We're starting to see things trend that way, although there are some folks that are still fighting to preserve. So I think it's a real issue, and I think the government has a role. On minimum wage. Look, I'm a labor economist now. I think a lot about how labor markets work and don't work. I'm working with Obama administration officials on getting the military personnel system to work a little bit better. We all seem to agree that that's become too bureaucratic. But when I see a law that says two consenting adults can't reach agreement, right? If a young man or a young woman wants to work for $7.50 an hour and that's illegal, and their alternative is to be unemployed, that looks a lot in the data, a lot like a glide path to Spain, where you see youth unemployment rates at 50%. Now, we've got communities in America where the youth unemployment rate is 50%, and guess what? A lot of those policies are protecting the jobs for those that have them and making it very hard for people to get started. So, you know, the metaphor that you see a lot in this debate is the economic ladder, and that bottom rung has been taken out, where you can't get started. That's wrong. If a young man or woman wants to work and somebody wants to employ them, they should be able to do that. Last statement I'll say is on entrepreneurship. When Jimmy Carter was president, 1 in 6 companies were startup companies every year. Boom, 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 boom. That number's been going down for every president. Today, it's 1 in 12 companies are startups. So when was that, 79, 35 years ago? I don't want to get to zero, right? Mm-hmm. And startups No. are not just tech companies in the peninsula, in the Bay Area, right? Tech companies are people that do, you know, retail. Doesn't sound sexy, but Walmart started out as a simple retail company. Five Guys hamburgers, hamburger stands. You can revolutionize logistics and food production just as much as you can revolutionize databases. But it gets really hard to start companies when there's occupational licensing, which over the last century has grown from basically zero to 30% of jobs are affected. You've got to have a license now to work in a nail salon, right? Let alone start it and hire other people. Economic studies say that we're in the states where there's an occupational license versus a state where there's not, there are 20% fewer jobs in that sector. So 30% of jobs require occupational licenses. That creates a 20% hit on the amount of jobs. That's, we have 6% fewer jobs in America than we could. If we have a workforce of about 100 million, that's 6 million jobs we're missing from our economy. And it's little micro things. It's all these little special interests that are protecting their little slice of industry. It's not a federal issue as much as it's a state issue, but I don't really hear anybody at the bully pulpit talking about it. And I know it's a left-right issue as well. Matt Iglesias has written passionately about this. Tyler Cowen has written passionately about this. These are friends of mine. I've written as a, you know, kind of right-leaning guy, pretty passionately about it. I care a lot about poverty, don't care so much about inequality, but we can fight inequality by getting at those issues.
Yeah, on the minimum wage, I agree with what Tim just said. If person A wants to work for person B and doesn't want to do it for 15 an hour, but wants to do it for 8 an hour or 5 an hour or 6.50, whatever, as long as nobody's there at gunpoint, as long as these people are over 18 and agree to this, it really isn't the government's damn business, number one. Number two, I find it fascinating that this came out just, I did a piece about this last, a couple weeks ago. There are 100, I think it's 197 Democratic sponsors in the Senate and the House for a federal bill to raise the federal minimum wage to $12 an hour. Of those 197 Democratic, all Democrat co-sponsors of this $12 an hour minimum wage, 94% of them, guess what they pay their summer interns? Zero. Zippo, okay? So let's start with them paying a minimum wage to the, that was, you can look at my piece at National Review Online, which gets into that in a great deal with all the sources. And I think they ought to, you know, let's start there. If they want to pay them $12 minimum wage, we can start with that. And also, if let's say you can't, why is it okay to pay somebody zero as an intern and say, well, you're getting experience, so work for nothing. But if you say to the person, look, I can't afford to pay you $7.50, but I can't pay you $5 an hour, that's against the law. Yeah. I find that insane. And last point on the minimum wage, why $15 an hour? Why not $100 an hour? Why don't we have a $100 minimum wage? Everyone will make about $250,000 a year. I did some calculations on this. With that level, a high level of income, almost everybody would be either in the top 1% or top 2%. And we could, with the money we raised through taxing people at $250,000 and above, we could probably pay off the national debt in about 4 or 5 years. So we should have $100 an hour minimum wage.
Yeah, wow. Let's jump into education shortly. You mentioned that a bit. DeRoy, you discussed that also. I think that the argument would be that not everyone has access to quality education or the opportunity to go to college. You know, but that doesn't mean that they should automatically be subjected to the lives of poverty. So my question is, you know, what is your take on school vouchers and what can be done to advance the policies that would actually give parents the choice to send their children to better schools?
So how many people in here have kids? Because that really revolutionized the way I think about this. So in our little neighborhood, we used to live in Vienna, Virginia, outside of DC, raised 4 kids there. So everything from, you know, we've still got a third grader up through, oh, she's a fourth grader now, up through college. And when people were debating President Bush's No Child Left Behind, which is a bipartisan bill, there are a lot of us who thought, I'm not sure this is the answer, right? More government involvement. And the metrics they used were odd. But I remember the fundamental point was that the government was going to come in and measure schools. And I'll tell you, the parents I talked to in the neighborhood, they didn't really need any help knowing how their school stacked up to other schools. And in particular, what really got me was the moms and the dads on the playground waiting for the kids to come out, especially when you would get the class assignment for the next year. And it's like, I shouldn't say her name. Somebody to think of a fake name. You've got Mr. Doherty. That's all right. It's only a year. We all knew who the good teachers were, not just the schools, the teachers. But my ability to go in and ask for a teacher change was impossible, essentially. And I thought, what if our cars were distributed the way our teachers are distributed? So. You know, in America, imagine if the government said, look, everybody deserves a car. Now, a lot of us don't want cars. We might live in the city. We might not like having the hassle. Nonetheless, we all need cars. It's the 21st century. So we're going to assign you not only the car dealership, we're going to assign you the vehicle that you're going to get from that dealership and the color. And it's going to be a good one. So don't worry about that. We'll pick the one that's best for you. But maybe you're crazy and you're 40 and you want a sports car, honey. It's okay. No. My point is people can pick what they want with the car market. I think we'd get a second American Revolution if we did to our car market what we do with our primary education. And yet we all just accept that. It's like frogs being boiled just because it's the way it's always been done. So I think you can get a revolution in this area by giving, and this doesn't sound very Republican, by spending a little more on education and having the government fund pre-K for everyone, but in the form of a scholarship. And have everyone take their kid to whatever pre-K they wanted to, and then turn around and go to kindergarten and have it be assigned, and there'll be a little revolution.
You know, when it comes to vouchers, a lot of people say, oh, you're for vouchers. You know, why do you hate the kids? That's the next question. Vouchers are a four-letter word, et cetera. And I tell them, I find it fascinating that there's all this controversy about vouchers from K through 12. You know, if you go to college, anybody ever get a Pell Grant? Anybody ever get a National Direct Student Loan or Stafford Loan or anything like that?
Yeah, I did.
Those are vouchers for college kids.
Right.
And you can take your voucher and you can go to Stanford, private secular school. You can go to USF, which is a Jesuit school. You can go to Brigham Young, Mormon school. You can go to yeshiva and have rabbis teach you.
You can go
and
that's Chico State.
You can go to Chico State if you want. You go to public school. So you take your voucher, and that's what it is. It's a voucher for college kids, and take it where you and your parents think you'll get the best education. And everyone's cool with that. But if you want a voucher for a third grader, which is a Pell Grant for a third grader, then you want to – why do you hate children, Paul? Why do you hate the kids? So I would suggest when people say, oh, my God, why are you for vouchers? Say, I want Pell Grants for kids K through 12. That's what we're talking about.
Right on. Great. I want to talk a little bit about technology and entrepreneurship in relation to the economy. Tim, in your recent Real Clear Politics piece, you argued that too many progressive laws are effectively anti-work and that the growth of federal regulations in the past half century correlates with the decline of startup companies and new jobs, as you mentioned earlier as well. But here in San Francisco, we don't necessarily see this problem. You know, as we live in what I believe to be the, you know, economic and technological hub of the U.S., maybe the world. And you also mentioned talking about Abraham Lincoln. The piece was published around the 150th anniversary of his assassination. And he argued forcefully for new industries and federal investments, and he argued against subsidizing old sectors. So can you explain this a little bit and sort of Lincoln's legacy and tie this back into sort of our modern economic?
I'll try to. I might drop the ball a little bit. So I mentioned one of my main points on entrepreneurship when I talk about this is that occupational licensing idea because it's so central. The complexity of regulations we saw in the presentation with the rising tax code, and any of those who've started a company, and I think that's the crowd here, you guys really get that. One of the companies I started was in California, down in San Diego, and we had three partners, and we just worked until basically we couldn't handle any more work, right? I felt like our skin was about to burst. We were just held as much in as we could, and we wanted to hire that first employee. But the stack of paperwork that we had to do to hire that first employee was probably going to take more work than the first employee was going to do. So there reaches this point where you need about three or four employees before it's worth it to set up all the apparatus. And I know now there are services that do all that paperwork for you, a lot of it, but then that's still an extra cost. And frankly, I didn't know that. Right? I didn't go to business school. I didn't know how to do it. All I knew was that when I called the 1-800 number for answers from the government, they sent me more instructions that I can digest. And it was incredibly intimidating that if we got something wrong, we could go to jail. And I remember my two other partners were much more worried about going to jail than I was. And so I just, you know, risk it. I'm like, I'm not going to read the whole thing. I'll try to file a couple of the forms. And I think they'll come and rather than put me in jail, they'll ask me for money. And so we'll risk it. In fact, that company got acquired, very small amount, so it's not a big deal. Three guys, a bunch of employees, 4 years of work, and we got $1 million acquisition. So it was cool, but you know, you do the math, and it really wasn't worth me not working for 4 years. It worked out, I guess, in the end. It was so intimidating. It was so scary. I think if I hadn't broken the law, we would have never gotten there. But I remember one of the acquiring lawyers did the, I didn't even know the vernacular, we need to do due diligence. And I thought he was saying do-do. Like, do-do. Do you know what I mean? And I'm like, it's so good. So anyway, sell a company. Guy's going through our books. He goes, we can't find your paperwork on workman's comp. And I said, you know, I'm an ex-Air Force officer. So I go, what is that? Right? So we've been like totally violating the law by not having our work. This is off the record. Right? Yeah. We're not. Anyway. So I just think that paperwork burden has gotten bigger and bigger. You see it in the tax code. I track numbers on startup creation, a database called Business Dynamic Statistics. It's going like this. We hit this last great recession. It went down further because legislators just want to try to fix things, and they seem to add more fixes in paperwork. So how does this tie into Lincoln? My answer is getting very long. Lincoln said we need to focus on growth industries. Manufacturing was the big sector back then. He was not a friend of the farmer. I make this point. He joined the Republican Party when he could have been a Republican or a Democrat. He joined the Whig Party when he could choose between Whig and Democrat. Those were the two capitalist parties. He clearly identified with capital because he thought it helped workers. The difference as an economist now, and you guys know this too, there's a big difference between the government investing in basic research versus picking winners and losers in the market, which car company to bail out or not. So I think that's, in short, the simple difference is there is a government role. I'm a lukewarm fan of things like DARPA, but I think the internet would have been created even without federal funding.
Yeah, I agree that when the government gets in the business of picking winners, and people always say the government shouldn't pick winners and losers, they tend to pick losers. I don't seem to pick very many winners.
Solyndra
comes to mind. The Heritage Foundation has something they call called Obama's high-tech graveyard or something like that. And I think they list like 19 companies in which the government has loaned money or given money. But see, Wall Street's spending private money. They're not spending your money. We shouldn't have bailed them out. I'm for capitalism on the way up and capitalism on the way down. I'm not for capitalism on the way up and socialism on the way down. So if you invest your own money and you lose it, you lose your own money. We should not be bailing out companies. If you make a bad investment, we shouldn't be bailing them out. I agree with you 100%. We should not be bailing out Wall Street. I was opposed to the Wall Street bailouts. I said, look, these guys made bad investments. They should eat it. And people say, oh, my God, AIG will go broke. No, somebody will come and buy it. So I agree with you, sir. You're absolutely correct. We should not be bailing out Wall Street. They should make their own decisions, and if they prosper, great. If they lose money, that's just too bad for them. I'll give you a couple examples of this problem with licensing and regulations and so on. I know of a company that is trying to cure cirrhosis of the liver, and they're trying very hard to take care of that disease. They're spending time and money to do the following. They're required by, I think it's FINRA, to track the process for their payment of invoices. It's a small company with an office of 3 or 4 people. So what happens is the mailman comes in, and he puts the mail on, I'm making up the names, on Sally's desk. She then takes it to Bob the treasurer. He opens it. He puts together an invoice, and then Jack the CEO signs it, and they put it in the mail. That's it. It's very simple. They've got to spend something like, I think, around $80,000 to $100,000 to write a workbook to explain this process. Then they have to get an outside auditor to come into the company and see if, in fact, it works that way. This is ridiculous. All these people want to do is cure cirrhosis of the liver, and instead they're jumping through these absurd, ridiculous hoops that don't create any value for anybody other than lawyers and accountants and auditors. This is something else which was in the Wall Street Journal. There's an excellent article. Any people here are fans of musicians or any musicians here? How many people here like musicians? This is a terrific article that ran, I think, on Friday in the Wall Street Journal. Headline is The Federal Marching Band of Music Regulators. This is Friday's opinion page of the Wall Street Journal. Superb article, horrifying about what the government is doing against musicians. And I'll just read you this one paragraph. In March 2013, the Federal Trade Commission turned its sights on the Music Teachers National Association, a 139-year-old organization comprised primarily of women who give piano lessons in their homes. The group's code of ethics, which discourages members from poaching one another's students, was deemed a restraint of trade. The association got off without a fine, but had to abandon its code of ethics, train members about, quote, anti-competitive practices, unquote, draft a 20-year compliance plan, and file annual updates with the Federal Trade Commission. Okay? This is what our government is doing today. So are we at all surprised that people are terrified about opening and expanding companies? Shouldn't scare us at all. What I'd like to see is bureaucrats scared rather than business people.
So, thank you. We have about 15 minutes, and I wanted to take some time, ask one last question, and then we'll go ahead and open it up for a quick Q&A session. Again, I wanted to just ask a question about technology. I work in technology PR. We're here in the hub of technology. You know, we're lucky enough to live in an era of artificial intelligence and 3D robotics. Internet of Things is coming along now. We have nanotechnology and other mind-blowing technologies that are really taking root. And so my question, I think, you know, is that do you see a future America where, you know, with Google driving cars and, again, with this idea of singularity, Google's director of engineering, Ray Kurzweil, saying that we'll have smart machines soon and in the next 20 years or so. So do you see a future America where we are taken over by robots, or were consumed by our technology?
So the businesses that are the most mechanized, the most capitalized, employ the most people. And this is just a transition. Everybody in this room could recite the story of when we went from agriculture to industry, we went through a transformation. 90% of Americans at the founding worked directly in farming. Now very few do. That's progress. Now we're going from industry to services, but services are going to be automated. I don't see that as a threat. And I'll just leave it short so that we can get to Q&A and turn it over.
I generally agree with that. The farm, I'm not a farmer, so I don't know quite the words, the farm harvester, the combine, was that a robot? You might consider that a robot of sorts. And as a, thanks to these robots, a lot of people, some of you folks here who are doing what you do now might instead be out in the Central Valley doing farming, because we wouldn't have had any other opportunity to feed ourselves. So that's a good thing. I do think in order for people to continue to remain hired as the robots take on more and more of what we do need to keep an economy that is vibrant and open enough so that somebody comes along with the next amazing idea we can't even imagine now. So those people who may have lost their jobs to the robots will find something else to do.
Great. All right. It looks like we have a few questions. I'll go ahead and start here in the back left.
Explain more about the prison.
Is there a question?
We are the most imprisoned nation in the incarceration rate per capita.
Well, I have to pay for that. Somebody has to pay for that. If I'm competing with somebody from England who has 1/10 the incarceration rate, they don't have to pay for that. It makes them more competitive. And when you start getting near the margins, this matters. Or if I'm selling into any global market, I'm having to carry the burden of that imprisonment. Yeah. And it can carry the burden of the last wars that we've been into. Yeah. And it's huge.
Well, I think this should be, you point out that things should be balanced, so there's a free market side, a Milton Friedman side of me that thinks, what's the one industry that would want to make sure you've got occupational licenses? And maybe that's medical, right? You want to make sure a doctor's got a license before he does surgery on you. But imagine a world where even doctors weren't licensed, but you actually knew everything about them, right? You knew the patient records, you saw a good evaluation from their patients. I would value that more than the murky system we have now. And I think all of us can tell some horror stories where a doctor gave my wife bad advice that would have killed one of our kids. Full stop. Now, I have access to academic journals, so I could go research the condition, and I found out the doctor was wrong. On my own. God bless the internet. I would much rather know about each of these pediatricians' histories, which I don't know today in this country, but they're licensed, Right, so I think you're right. There's got to be balance. There are reasons for safety rules. I was in violation of law. I should have paid the fine. But we were a software business too, right? So we had three employees. So I'm saying you're right, and trying to defend myself a little bit so I don't get in too much trouble. You're right. There should be some balance here. On the prison one, it's murky. I think there's a lot of exploitation of poor people in this country, and a lot of times it's by abusive police, right?
Yes.
We can get into that. I think it's tangentially applied to this, and I think it gets back to a lot of kids turn to crime because they can't read. I would still come back to that as boil everything down. If I could fix one thing to fight inequality, I submit that's still it, and I don't think that's vapid at all. We got a lot of questions, so let us try to get to other people. Yeah.
I agree with that comment, and the focus in school generally should be with inner city kids, particularly poor black kids. I want to see high expectations. I think, unfortunately, our school system, there's the tendency to think, well, they're poor, they're minorities, so let's teach them down here. We should teach them up here, just like the kids in Atherton, or just like the kids in Hillsborough, or the Upper East Side of Manhattan. And when people rise to the level of expectations that are set for them, and if you set expectations low, that's where they perform. If you set them high, they do better. So we ought to be raising the level of expectations of kids who go to school, and that'll be good for the long-term prospects. In terms of prison, I agree with you, there is a big problem, and that is we lock up a lot of people for nonviolent crimes, very often drug-related. I think ending the drug war would be a big help in terms of that, and I would leave room in prison for people who are violent, who hurt people, and not for people who are smoking grass or
so
what have you.
So we're going to go. We're going to go in the order I saw the hands. Go ahead, sir.
I noticed, you know, there is I think a major trend among conservatives in America and Republicans towards freedom, and as a libertarian activist, I welcome this, and I can also relate because I grew up in a conservative household myself, made that journey. So I was delighted to hear both you guys, you Tim, saying that if somebody wants to hire somebody else for X dollars per hour and the other person wants to hire them, that should be just between them. The government shouldn't get involved. And DeRoy, you agreeing with this, so I'd just like to hear you guys explicitly affirm, you know, that this applies to victimless so-called crimes like prostitution, drug use, offshore gambling, et cetera. I'm a sex worker. I'm tired of being criminalized. I'm tired of my clients being criminalized for trying to make an honest living and provide a good service to them. It's not hurting anybody else. Are you guys for this?
I'll take it on. So I tend to favor liberty. And I think you need to make an exception why there isn't liberty in every market, frankly. I do give deference to communities to make up their own rules, but I think if California wants to decriminalize marijuana, I think it's great.
What if California wants a $15 an hour?
No, I do. I think that's great too. But I would like, in fact, the law right now is written.
Yeah, I think it'll hurt people. I think decriminalizing prostitution and drug use also hurts people. I think we should stand against these things, even if most of the community wants it. Just because something's popular doesn't make it right. It's morally wrong for them to criminalize innocent people.
But so the policy point is, I think states and communities have to be able to experiment. And so when Colorado's decriminalizing marijuana, I think that's great. When California or Seattle, Los Angeles raises the minimum wage, I'm actually in favor of that. I don't want to see it mandated nationally, and I would really like to see a level playing field. So in Idaho or Ohio, they could lower the minimum wage. I mean, maybe, you know, the governor hates his people and he's going to lower the minimum wage, but maybe he'd employ teens, and it would be good for working conditions there.
There was an excellent John Stossel special maybe 3-4 years ago. Maybe five, and he went to, up to Canada, Montreal, Toronto, I forget which town, and actually visited a motel room where a prostitute and a John were about to engage in a transaction. Client, very good. Anyway, and so she had a great point. She said, listen, people go to Las Vegas to watch one boxer pound another boxer to the point where he gets, you know, bloody eyes and knocked on the ground and all that. They pay money. These guys get paid, you know, $1 million. The loser gets $1 million. The winner gets $5 million. And that's okay. But if I want to give pleasure to my client for $500, that's against the law. Please explain.
Good. Yes, sir.
So, Dr. Kane, I'm a fellow officer with the Air Force Academy.
Great.
My name is Rommel Fox. My company is WomenTours.com Incorporated. We do scientific research. My topic is American competitiveness. One thing that I discovered, all the discussions everybody has seem to focus on debate, I discovered that there's actually a law in 1992, Title 29, Chapter 27. Women were supposed to receive training from all companies in order that they would be in every present occupation today. So I offer free tech training for women and so on. So I'm asking you as a fellow officer, what do you think is we as officers can do more in terms of complying with law and teaching other businesses that there are laws in the books that if we can do more and comply with the laws to offer more opportunity?
I think I'm going to give a terrible answer here, and you may have more knowledge and information to recommend than I do. I think the military is a great leadership organization. I've been doing some research recently on their management practices, and they tend to be a little bit archaic. So, you know, if you had these two axes, great leadership, culture, mentoring, and that sort of thing, very weak on performance evaluations, right? Everybody walks on water because they don't have the moral courage to give good evaluations. They don't have good peer evaluations like the private sector tends to do. But I don't think that answers your question, so I don't follow. Maybe you can give us a little bit more information on what your thinking is.
Address the barriers, and one of the barriers I do is I give free tech training for women. So I'm looking to, you know, more Air Force officers or anyone that's willing to say, this is the law in the books, this is what we should do and comply, as opposed to debating about it. Huh. So I'm asking you, like, what more can we do as Air Force officers, you know, to get more out here to comply?
That's a good point. Well, I think I might disagree with you, but I feel like I'm ignorant in answering this. So. Too much training in the military. Like, it took me 9 months to get to my first assignment, right after I graduated with this great academy education, and we were in the middle of a war, and it was over by the time I got there. I thought, maybe I could have done a little OJT. I mean, all I was doing was, I was an intel guy giving briefings, on the job training. I think governments tend to require too much training instead of making it easier for people to get jobs and learn on the jobs. And usually training requirements are what the industry wants to protect themselves from new entrants. Short answer, we'll try to get to some others.
I am strictly a beneficiary of the outstanding and courageous performances and service of the U.S. Armed Forces, so I'll defer to Professor Kane's comments.
Good. Yes, ma'am.
I'm just curious why you don't compare us to other wealthy, successful nations, like, for instance, Scandinavian countries that have far lower childhood poverty rates and much better outcomes.
Yeah.
And they have engaged pretty actively, especially in early childhood government programs. I'm curious why you don't compare us to them.
Sure. I'm just an arrogant imperialist tonight. I love these international comparisons. Actually, for a year, I was the editor of the Wall Street Journal Heritage Index of Economic Freedom. So what I think is interesting in that debate is when you compare America to Northern European countries, they're actually better on a lot of the economic freedom scores. The Southern European economies aren't. So don't ever let anybody say, oh, Europe versus America, right? They're very different models over there. We probably have something in this country to learn from every one of them. But the bottom line is still, as far as major industrial countries, we're the wealthiest in per capita terms. Even when we're critical, we tend to have lighter regulation than most other places. But we have a lot to learn. I think the Nordic economies in particular, I keep an eye on.
Yeah, I was just going to say that Sweden, a lot of people say, oh, you know, socialist Sweden, those left-wing people, ha-ha. They now have, I think, a pretty close to universal voucher system. Mm. They also have, if not full privatization of Social Security, something along those lines. They're very free trade. I went to a conference in Sweden probably roughly about 1998, 1999, and I heard this speech by, remarks by a member of the government there. I thought I was sitting next to Milton Friedman, and this guy was actually a socialist minister. And he said, yeah, when it comes to spending and stuff, we spend money, but we believe in free trade, because if we didn't do that, we would have starved 500 years ago. So they definitely, there are aspects of the market model you see even in a place like Sweden more today than in the past.
So we've got... So there's a great add-on here to get back to what we're supposed to be talking about, inequality, in that we have the most open economy in the world to immigrants. And we import a lot of low-skill, poor immigrants with literacy problems. Is that a problem? A lot of conservatives think it is. I don't think it is. But it makes our inequality statistics look really bad. It makes the education problem look even worse than it probably is. I'm trying to give you a break. I'm trying to agree that I think immigration is good. I think it's good for the immigrants. I think it's good for America. It can make the statistics look bad.
I know somebody, a friend of mine who got an MBA from Vanderbilt, excuse me, and a friend of his a Russian guy, got a job offer from Bechtel to work on pipelines, and he was very psyched to get his MBA and go to work for Bechtel. And they called him about a week later and said, hey, we got really bad news. Unfortunately, the H-1B visa quota has run out, and you're great. We can't wait to have you come work here, but we can't give you a visa. We can't give you a visa. A, we can't hire you. B, you've got, I think it was 14 days to pack up and get the hell out of here. And now he's building pipelines for Vladimir Putin rather than in this country. So there's a great example of how the immigration laws can backfire.
All right, sir, you were next. Then I'll go here in back.
Yeah.
Go
ahead. And the purpose was so that the people who were at the very bottom of the economic ladder could get jobs pricing on the labor market, because eugenics was a big thing back then. And they thought those people who were those classes were genetically inferior.
That was a feature, not a bug, was to price these.
Kind of like the idea of reinstituting a kind of natural selection thing in society to get rid of these people. And I thought, of course, the United States would take on more of a racial aspect. I'm wondering, is it possible that then some of the people on the minimum wage are living in the same way that our fellow
adults? I think that's probably one. But I do think there are ulterior motives, you know, to a lot of people's policy desires. Kennedy famously, when they were working on the Civil Rights Bill before he was assassinated, which maybe was what pushed it into existence in 64, there were a lot of purists who didn't want to have a bill passed. They wanted to keep fighting about it. And he made this comment, like, I can't do a good JFK impression, but they want a bill, you know, or they want a fight, I want a bill. Those were all, you know, those were his allies. I think that happens with the immigration debate. There are a lot of people that like to fight and never solve it, which drives me crazy, right? Because I'd like to see a functioning, more open guest worker program. But yeah, I think there are some ulterior motives, and I think people delude themselves. There are a lot of the unions that were pushing for a higher minimum wage in Los Angeles, and then immediately backtracked when it was passed. It's like, whoa, wait, there's an exemption right for union workforces. We don't have to pay those high wages. So, yeah, there's a lot of agitation that goes on until the consequences come due, and people want carve-outs. And a lot of times they get the carve-outs. I don't think so, but... All right, I've been hogging
Believed that, I don't think this person would say that in public. I do think it was very interesting, as you mentioned, in Los Angeles, the union screamed and yelled for the $15 per hour minimum wage, and literally like 4 or 5 days later, they said, all right, well, we want to carve out for unionized companies. And I think that was all about, all right, we want to get more people to sign up for the unions, even if it means that their own workers are not going to be making 11, 12, 13, 10, whatever, less. That was the level of hypocrisy and cynicism in that example I thought was absolutely breathtaking. And I'm somebody who follows hypocrisy and cynicism for a living.
All right. DeRoy's going to answer the next one first. So, yeah.
Basic income guarantee proposals. I think Milton Friedman proposed it first. It's been embraced by some economists on the left, as well as some tax leaders here. If you're not familiar with it, it's the idea that everybody gets $25,000, $30,000, whatever the sum is, no matter what.
The sum of government was in favor of a guaranteed minimum income.
I disagree with the government just giving money people for giving money's sake. I think you ought to work for it. Now, it's one thing if you are handicapped or if you have severe health problems or you're autistic or something like that. Yes, we should be very generous with people who can't take care of themselves. But the notion that everybody should, you know, go to the mailbox and open up and get a check from Uncle Sam, I'm against that. If you want a check, you should work for it, unless you're physically or mentally unable to do so.
All right, so here we disagree. And this is worth me adding a little bit. So there's a division among in the conservative movement and the liberal movement and centrists about whether or not you should means test programs to make them more affordable. One of my very best friends thinks we need to means test Social Security because rich people shouldn't get Social Security. And I think that's a crazy idea. I think we should means test nothing, right? So Social Security right now, if you're wealthier, you get a bigger Social Security check, which I don't think works very well. And the proposal is that actually the... What's that?
If you've had more money withheld.
Oh, yeah, that's right. So you've had more withheld, but then you get...
You earn
But you make more out of the program than you put in long term. So I still think a flat, everybody gets the same, is the sort of program I'd be for, but I wouldn't means test it. And in fact, there's a bill called, or a book, Charles Murray's The Plan. I can't remember the title of it. But he talks about replacing, what's that?
The Murray Plan?
We'll call it the Murray Plan. Let's replace all of the programs that we have with one guaranteed income. And I think it would, you'd add a ton of efficiency. You'd pull out all the anti-work incentives that are there now. I think it'd be great. So I'll just have to, can't flesh it out because we need to wrap. And I need...
Let me just add a brief few seconds.
So we can't disagree and then shut down debate.
No, we do disagree on this, which is, I think this government, unfortunately, has sort of what I call a fire hose approach to spending, which is you just turn on the hose and spray everybody. A good example of that was the Medicare drug plan, which was pushed by Karl Rove, signed by G.W. Bush. And the idea was to give drug insurance, not just to poor seniors who lacked drug insurance, but to all seniors over 65, regardless of income, including those who already had drug insurance. So therefore, you get somebody like, you know, Warren Buffett or like Bill Gates Sr., who's got billions in the bank, and we're all paying for his, you know, his Lipitor or whatever else the drug is. I think this is absurd and ridiculous. And I want to see a situation where we do affluence test everything. And if you can afford it, hey, pay for it yourself. And again, if you're poor, you can't take care of yourself, then we give you some generous benefits because you have no other options. And I'd much rather we have a situation where we don't give anything to Warren Buffett, but if you've got somebody who's 85 years old, she needs her pain medication or her blood pressure pills, we don't expect this 85-year-old lady or 87-year-old man to go back to work. All right, we'll take care of you, and we'll take care of you generously.
Yes, sir.
To some extent, guaranteed income would be a good way to kind of wing ourselves off of welfare, like over like a long period of time, maybe reduce the payments over a five-year period. But my question was, as you know, it's about framing the political debate, and often the left, you know, uses such slogans as the top 1%. But you know, there's been studies done before about how like the top 1% over like a 10-year period may fluctuate.
Yeah.
You might only have like maybe even 10% remain in that category for more than a couple of years because you know, you might make $1 million 1 year, you might not work the other year. So my question is, how do we get past these arbitrary statistics where they don't really kind of get into detail about how revolving and how what the turnover rate among the top 1% is? How do you kind of convey that message that some people do get rich, they might not make money the next year, then other people may get rich, and it's a constantly revolving door?
So I'll go that's a great point. It's a little bit wonky, and I think sometimes in political debates you don't have time to go there because then it sounds defensive. I tend to say, you know, debate tactic wise, just give. Just say, yep, there's inequality. Why? Because some kids are not learning in schools, right? So I think it's more effective to go after that. And then you can point out this unionized teachers where you get the worst teachers in the world and they've got tenure and they're not moving. And then kids just get stuck in those classrooms. That to me paints a better picture than, you know, your typical NFL player, your average career is about 2.5 years. Those guys make a lot of money for 2.5 years. Yeah, so they pay a lot of taxes, and then you find a lot of these guys are, you know, professional athletes are homeless 10 years later. Yeah, so I tell Wesley Snipes, you know, and then vampires, man, are out of control. So, you know, look, that's why I tell my story. We worked hard for 4 years. We got $1 million acquisition. I didn't get a third of that, but let's assume I got roughly a third of it. I was in the top 1% for one brief shining moment, and I literally forgot that I was going to owe taxes because I'd been poor as a starving grad student for so long. I'm like, holy cow, how much are they going to take? A third? And then that was it. We didn't make a lot of money then for a while. Now, I don't want to, you know, boo-hoo for me because I'm doing great in life. But that was really frustrating. You know, I was like, why am I the bad guy all of a sudden? I created jobs for people. You fulfill the American dream. I want to buy a house for my kids. And I did, and then I forgot I owed money, so I was scrambling. I was like really stressed and went right back to zero income basically the next year. So yeah, don't feel bad for me. Feel bad for other people that have some peak earning years where they barely scrape the top 5%. but they're hitting that 30% income, and then they don't make it the rest of their lives. I think it's deeply unfair. And until you go to a consumption tax, which doesn't punish people for saving, you're going to get this false inequality debate punishing the wrong people.
Professor Kane's made a lot of very good points, and I just add this, that maybe what we ought to do is stop focusing on the 1%, and why don't we instead focus on the bottom 20%, or the bottom 40% for that matter, and say, okay, are they falling? Are they going up? What can we do to make sure that they go up, not down? And let's have the focus on what we can do to bring that floor up and spend a lot less time focusing on, you know, who's on top of the roof. And let's focus on the people down here. What can we do to bring them up rather than drag these people down to the ground? Which have, I don't have anything on those specific families, but I did show data on the top 1%. I would think the Rockefellers and the Rothschilds are probably in the top 1%. I'm guessing, yeah. So, but right. I'm sorry, don't have those specific data on those families, I'm afraid. Yeah. Always said it.
Yeah. I think
that's it.
About done. We're out of time for the evening, so I'd like to give a quick round of applause to our two panelists. And thank you for being here, everyone, and thanks once again to Runway Incubator for having us, and also to the Arthur Roop Foundation for sponsoring this event. Thanks.